Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. We thank you for keeping it urban. Now, KCCA is again at the eye of the storm. The president recently made changes in the leadership of the technical wing. And amongst those affected was the Lord Mayor's right arm. It was chopped off. And one of our guests tonight is none other than the Lord Mayor of Kampala Capital City Authority, Ssaalongo Erias Lukwago. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Nicholas, and good evening, viewers.
Lord Mayor, before we go into the beef of our discussion today, one would wonder, has COVID-19 affected work at Kampala Capital City Authority or the City Hall in any way?
Well, like it is happening in the rest of the world, the systems have been paralyzed, not only in the country, but of course, even here at KCCA, you know, we are just emerging out of this debilitating lockdown, which has really affected a number of people, disrupted the normal programming of institutions and also individual work. So basically, as KCCA here, the case is not anywhere different because we are having to scale down on the number of staff, and we are one of those agencies which are at the forefront of fighting COVID. Yes.
As the political head, how have you managed this kind of situation?
It's a bit of a challenge because the functioning of the institution itself was paralyzed, because COVID has been handled from the center. You know, you are aware there is a national task force which took charge of most of the COVID-related activities. And even at a local level, there was a way local institutions or agencies, authorities, or administrative units have been sidelined. You know, they are not part of the task forces. It's largely centered at a different level. You know, you have the RDCs, the RDCs, who have taken center stage in these activities, which to me, I think wasn't a proper arrangement, because we should have structured it in such a way that all government agencies, all institutions, all leaders get to play an active role one way or the other, including the parliament, KCCA, local governments, and all the other individuals. Unfortunately, that was never to be the case. But that notwithstanding doesn't mean playing any significant role. At individual level, yes, we've tried our best. At even in level, we retain the power, the mandate of supervising what is happening, what is going on, largely auditing what is being done by the task forces. There are some people who are drafted into the National Task Force from here, the ED, the deputy and the others. And of course, there were some allocations were made to KCCA. Initially, we needed some good amount of money to be able to combat the spread of the virus, and also to be in a position to deal with the attendant challenges, socioeconomic and otherwise. So we prepared a budget that was submitted to the ministry. It was in the region of 11 million, I mean, or rather 11 billion Uganda shillings. Unfortunately, no. Along the way, there were some adjustments that were made when it was taken to the Ministry of Kampala. It was enhanced to 30 billion. I'm not privy to what informed that decision, but in the wisdom of the minister, and I think the team they worked with in the ministry, they raised it to 30 billion, and that's what was presented to Parliament. But Parliament rejected that. And indeed, what was appropriated ultimately was 2 billion, one for KCCA and one for the ministry. And personally, I retained the power and authority to, or should have been involved in the actual appropriation, unfortunately. Still, the arrangement could not allow some of us to get involved. The councils were called off because there was a directive that the councils shouldn't sit. But the executive committee continued sitting. and we have been sitting together with the technical team, and largely the work we have been doing is auditing, is supervision, monitoring, to ensure that at least there is value for money, that money serves the purpose it was intended to, and we continue to pursue that role. And indeed, we have lined up a series of activities to be undertaken, including council meetings, in line with that accountability process. Yes.
Lord Mayor, in your explanation, you seem to be saying there is a bit of political influence from the central government in the way affairs are managed at KCCA. But besides influence from the central government, we understand that in Kampala's politics, there are very many power centers, the church, the Muslim fraternity, the traditional institutions like Mengo. One would then wonder, how do these very many power centers within the central or the city, do they in any way affect management of affairs at KCCA?
I would like to look just on the flip side of it, the positive side of it. Rather than looking at that as a liability, it should be a blessing to us that we have so many other institutions which can come on board to play a significant role in this fight. Problem is on how you synergize, how you harness all these different forces available, you galvanize them, you so that they coalesce behind a particular project, program. And I think that has always been the critical challenge, because we are told by the president this is a battle where we should all get involved. So if you have religious-based organizations, you have civil society, you have traditional institutions, you have different organizations within the sectors here in Kampala, for example, the traders, those in the public transport sector, those in the informal businesses, in arcades, in markets, and whatnot. So we needed to galvanize all these efforts. We needed to create a network, to come up with a network that would bring together all these different power centers you are talking about, these different institutions, these different groupings, and these different interest groups, so that we come up with a minimum program that would take us to a particular direction. Unfortunately, that did not happen, simply because right from the center, the fight against COVID was not properly structured. It was more or less like organized at a level of the presidency. Even parliament was never involved in this war exercise. Yet there was a war outlay within our constitution. There is that framework provided for within the constitution that should you be faced as a nation with a crisis of this magnitude, the pandemic of this nature, you have no choice but to declare a state of emergency. That is the import of Article 110 of the constitution, if you are to deal with that. And it's not about just, because when you talk about a state of emergency, what immediately comes to the mind of an individual is violation of people's rights, is usurpation of the powers of different institutions and agents, and also having dictatorial monolithic tendencies within the country. Far from that, actually the spirit and letter of Article 110 is totally different from what people perceive as what should be happening in a state of emergency. In other words, actually, there is distribution of power within Article 110, when it comes to fighting a pandemic of this nature. Parliament is given its own role. The president, yes, like a president, he has to, of necessity, consult the cabinet, because it's a constitutional command in Article 110 that the president has to come up with a proclamation in a consultation with the cabinet. And he doesn't proceed to enforce it or implement it unless it has been sanctioned by parliament. So you can see now at that level, parliament is involved in a decision-making process to decide which mechanism we should have in place to combat a pandemic of this nature. So this was never to be the case, because there was no proclamation taken to parliament, neither was there any arrangement involving any government or state agents or institution. The other thing is, the measures undertaken at that level, should cascade to different levels. They should come to local governments, lower administrative units, division, urban councils, and so on and so forth, drawing from the national framework. Unfortunately, that was not there. And that's what should incorporate the plans, because there must be a plan. Since if you are telling us that this is a war is planned from the beginning up to the end. So there was no plan, comprehensive plan rolled out, detailing all those mechanisms and measures. And those measures, finally, must have a force of law. That's why Parliament is given the powers under Article 110, that whatever measures initiated within that particular proclamation, they must be given a force of law one way or the other. So Parliament would be very busy right now enacting legislations on curfew, legislations on closing down the borders, closing down the airports, closing down people's businesses like it's been the case, about public transport, all this. There should be legislations. It's not enough to say that there's a Public Health Act which was made pursuant to the provisions of, say, of the 1935 Public Health Act. That was not sufficient at all, because that law is, its scope is very narrow. It's limited to dealing with
some Lord Mayor, smaller issues. One would argue that since COVID-19, the pandemic did not issue a warning, probably there's no time to plan for how to combat it and how to legislate upon which laws that we could use under the circumstances.
Well, it's granted. This pandemic is a global tragedy of unprecedented magnitude. That's a fact which is granted. And indeed, many states were caught off guard. But we got early warning signs. We got early warning indicators. It didn't start here. If we are talking about Wuhan, for example, that they had to fidget around, that could be understandable, because that's where it started from. If you're talking of the cradle, the epicenter of COVID, Wuhan comes into one's mind. But by the time it started spreading to Europe, to America, now Africa, we ought to have gotten the signs. As early as January, we had already gotten notice, because in Wuhan it was... That's the reason, actually, it's called COVID-19. It happened in 2019. We went into Christmas season fully aware that it was on the way coming, just like we have been preparing for the invasion of the locusts, that they are coming. We have been preparing. And in any case, even if you are talking about certain disasters, they are all predictable in most cases. Yes, if you are prone to this, there are areas which are prone to mudslides, there are areas prone to earthquakes. I'm having now a global picture. You get to prepare accordingly. So we ought to have known that we are prone to COVID because it was in China and we have those strong business ties with China, just like we know that we are prone to this other disastrous disease from DRC, Ebola. Yes, and we ought to have prepared accordingly. It was declared a pandemic, I think, towards the end of January by World Health Organization. We ought to have known that. And the first time we came up with the measures was 18th March. So there was some delay, whether it was inadvertent, deliberate. Bottom line is we ought to have prepared adequately. Yes.
Lord Mayor, moving on, one of the long-standing issues at the City Hall is absence or lack of substantive office bearers in different offices in KCCA. Does this in any way concern you, and does it affect service delivery in the city?
I'm very much concerned about this issue, because I believe for us to deliver on the mandate provided for in the KCCA Act, and in all the instruments guiding the activities of KCCA, you must have a robust, vibrant, and strong institution. And there is no way you can develop, a stronger institution unless you have the necessary structures in place. The reason we have the leadership structure in place is to have an organized institution. And that's why we regularly hold elections to have a Lord Mayor, to have councillors, and to have bears and what, so that you have in place the leaders. And that's the reason the framers of the law provided for the staff structure, that there should be a staff structure detailing the different levels. Those who are at the directorate level, the 10 directors, the ED, the deputy, those who are at a managerial level, supervisors, and so on, because each of them has got a role to play. And the reason we have public staff, the Employment Act, this public service standing orders, you need to have that element of certainty. It's so critical in any given work you are doing, that element of certainty. So people should know who is doing what, who is holding which particular position and for what particular term, and what are the terms of references, and what are the do's and the don'ts, so that you get to know from the word go, like it's the case with the Lord Mayor. I'm here, I know what I'm supposed to be doing, which is clearly spelled out under the law, and I know my tenure, that it's 5 years, and I have to prepare accordingly. So that guides my work plan, so that I get to understand that within such and such a period, I should have accomplished A, B, C, D. But when you have an institution where people are uncertain about their tenure of office, their contracts, the terms of reference, there is overlap of roles, you have no clear order in the house, it creates institutional inertia. So what we are witnessing right now in KCCA, there is that problem of institutional inertia, whereby everything cannot move unless the center acts. So it can't set itself in motion. The agency here, it's difficult right now for us to generate our own programs. Right now, we don't even have a valid strategic plan, because the relevant office that is supposed to kickstart the process, you have problems there. Somebody there maybe is not so sure about their positions in office, so probably their terms of reference, and there is also that kind of feeling of, you know, despondence and whatnot. So right now, it has really adversely affected the performance of the institution. And the KCCA is the word acting is now synonymous with the KCCA. We have been having acting ED, acting deputy ED, and many of them for more than a year, or more than 1.5 years. Acting director treasury, acting director physical planning, acting director legal, acting deputy acting, this one also acting on behalf of another one, and this one retires or resigns, another acting comes in, they are not confirmed. There's no way you
Lord
can
Mayor,
build,
but now that
let me conclude this. There's no way you can build a robust, vibrant, and sustainable institution with that kind of environment.
But now that, yes, they have been acting, but now the president has appointed a substantive ED, for example, and filled most of the directorates, do you think residents in Kampala should now expect better?
Well, it may be too early to pass an objective judgment, because we don't know what the new appointments would do. Herald for us what is coming, what is in the pipeline. In the first place, they have not been comprehensive enough. It's only the deputy ED and the 3 directors. We have 10 directorates here. So what happens? Yes, no, in total they are 10. But apart from the ED and deputy ED, the appointments, the instrument I saw in the press, is about 3 directors. Director for gender, that is the former deputy Lord Mayor. Director for human resource and administration, and also director for public health. How about other critical directorates? Human resource. No. Treasury. Legal. Physical planning. And others. What is happening there? And their deputies and what not, they are all in acting capacity.
As political head, don't you have a way of interjecting and raising this issue that it is critical so that work can progress?
But we have sounded ourselves hoarse on this matter. Time and again, we have come out to bring it to the attention of the appointing authority and the powers that be, that the situation in the institution, as far as structure arrangement is concerned is dire. We have always sounded ourselves hoarse. We have raised it with the Parliament in a number of memoranda presented before Parliament. It has been one of those key issues I've presented there. I've raised it with the, even in the judicial at one time, we went there challenging quite a number of things. So we have raised it, even the minister, they are all aware. I don't know the reason why there is no enthusiasm from within the powers that be about streamlining the functioning of the institution of KCCA. I don't know whether it is deliberate, they enjoy it that way, and it is intended actually to paralyze the work, to create animosity, to create confusion. You know, crisis entrepreneurs. There are people who are called crisis entrepreneurs. They like crisis so that they can leverage their fortunes on that. So probably there are people who are enjoying this crisis.
Lord Mayor, we are going to continue this conversation after the break. You are still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja, and our guest tonight is the Lord Mayor of Kampala Capital City Authority, Ssaalongo Erias Lukwago. Lord Mayor, when we broke off, we were still discussing some of the issues at KCCA. Everyone knows you as a person of who is committed to upholding integrity and fighting what you would call the corrupt. But I would say that this challenge persists in the institution that you're presiding over.
Well, I would like to approach it from a broader perspective. It's a malaise we are facing as a country. Corruption is pervasive in all government institutions and agencies. And I think it's a challenge we need to confront as a nation, because it's everywhere and it is becoming like a part of our day-to-day lives. It's becoming one of the customs we have in the country, and that is dangerous. You ask yourself, where is the missing link? We have a robust legal framework to deal with corruption, graft in this country. In fact, as we talk right now, you don't need any other legislation in any place. I've heard people talking about strengthening the laws, that they could be weak here and there. If I were to mention the laws we have in place, I don't think you need any other legislation. Two, the institutional framework. I'm telling you, if you were to give the list of all the institutions we have to fight corruption in this country, you can see that we have more than enough, actually. Their mandate in some cases overlaps. When you have the IGG doing almost the same work that is being done by the anti-corruption unit within State House headed by Nakalema, you can see there is an overlap of the work. The CID, you have the different institutions we have here, those who are enforcing the leadership code, those who are enforcing all these anti-corruption laws, and so on and so forth. So it's not because we have a poster of legal framework or a poster of institutional framework. It's rather want of a political will to fight corruption in this country. And it all starts from the top. My language is the same, cook in Nyenkuru, Yigirizentokinamjis. So it starts from the top. That's the reason we have challenged President Yoweri Museveni. He should come out strongly. The other day there was an attempt to posture, I'm sorry to say this, it was posturing, when they said they are assembling to have a walk against corruption. There was a march what came out of that? Isn't it about time to assess the achievement, the value of that, the results? What did we get as returns from that match, the high build match, which was so much hyped, led by the president from State Square? They walked through our streets here, Kampala Road to Kololo, and therefore, how many heads have rolled? How many people have been prosecuted? That brings me now to KCCA here. It's not enough to say you are purging the institution, you are shuffling one individual from here to another, like you are dealing with the rotten eggs. It's not enough to throw out somebody, to terminate their contracts. They must crack the whip. There must be prosecution with hard-hitting evidence of particular individuals. And say a high-ranking officer from such and such institution. Now I'm talking about cases. Tell me how many people have been prosecuted here. Tell me that we have had, I don't want to mention the names here. It may be prejudicial. But I'm just talking about the office that saw and so, ED, Deputy ED, the directors or the political leaders, or that this one is facing charges in courts of law. So if you are not prosecuting individuals in courts of law, in the anti-corruption division of the High Court, tell me, how else are we fighting corruption? And it's not my mandate and powers here to fight. For us, we do our best. We have really done our best to unearth fraud here. The filth there is here, we have brought it on the surface. There are a number of, because personally I was given powers to appoint the Public Accounts Committee. I did that. Took the names to council, they were vetted, and they started their work. They have unearthed scandals here, scandal after scandal. There are so many shady transactions they have highlighted here. The legal department, to the extent that, as we talk right now, many of our accounts have been frozen. There are illicit deals, transactions going on. And our accounts being frozen, there are garnishee orders being issued by a court, left, right, center. So our debt portfolio in terms of legal liability is over 100 billion. So you ask yourself, who is responsible for all that? Who should be held accounted? Who should be subpoenaed by court to go and take a plea? And then you bring out charge sheets there. So we need to wake up to that reality, that there is no political will in this country to fight corruption.
Lord Mayor, you called it posturing, but what you've termed posturing culminated into changes in many of the institutions. You are nearer, and it ended in your backyard.
And the prosecutions. I want a list of how many, and it doesn't even stop at that, because you have to pursue it up with logical conclusion. People should be punished, they should be prosecuted, and convictions must be secured and must be taken to Luzira. I will ask you, tell me how many people are in Luzira on account of graft after?
Lord Mayor,
after that much hyped exercise.
You've said that in your council you've instituted mechanisms and put in place accountability committees and unearthed corruption in the institution that you head.
Yes.
I would pose the question to you, how many people have you ensured that are prosecuted?
I don't have the arresting powers. Neither do I have powers to prosecute anyone. My role is to handle the processes internally here by bringing out these reports. We debate them, we make recommendations.
There are
recommendations we have. Quite a number of them. We have asked for the intervention of the government offices, the Auditor General, in a number of cases calling for forensic audit, in a number of unexplained expenditures here. We have called for the intervention of CID. We have called for prosecution of some directors here. At one time, we even took a petition to Parliament and called for actions against the then ED
and specifying the amounts of money which could not be accounted for, which were found on over 150 something accounts that were frozen. We inherited different accounts from local governments, because the practice was that the local governments had different accounts opened up in so many banks here in Kampala. There were over 150. So in total, we discovered there was over 50 billion on those accounts. To date, it hasn't been accounted for. And so many other things.
So are you saying there is no end in sight?
No, let me tell you this. Mm. I heard recently, you know, the chair for the fundraising committee of the National Task Force for COVID, Katongole, this businessman Katongole, he was saying he was chest thumping himself that now they have so far collected around 30 billion. And said this is a tremendous work they have done. Then I said, well, does this man know what he's talking about? Purchase of Usafi alone cost 43 billion. So you have not even raised money that would buy just a small market, a Ramushakodi market here. And you are collecting for a national cause to fight COVID countrywide.
But that pricing was challenged. So
this is what I'm asking. How many people were prosecuted in respect to that fraudulent and shady transaction, the Usafi deal? How many people? It is a scandal. It's a national scandal. But how many people were called to account? Nobody. And for me, my duty was to bring out this information and we document it. We did that. So action should be taken by other people, not myself. I don't have those powers.
Lord Mayor, were you as surprised when your deputy was appointed Director Gender, Labor and Production?
Yes. It took me by surprise. It's the least I expected. Because there was nowhere she had indicated that she was about to retire or switch to another portfolio. Nothing. We are moving on normally. It just came abruptly. I was shocked.
But time and again, in your tenure, there are several other people that have left your sideline. Is it you, the individual, or is it your policies that cause people to abandon your cause and follow different directions?
But I always get the trust of the people. So you'll ask yourself, why is it that the people of Kampala have not revoked their mandate from me? I keep on getting over 75% of the votes. So you'll ask yourself, if the people of Uganda have trust in me, and there are some individuals, one or two, who find it difficult to get along with me, so wherein lies the problem? Can they go back and explain to the bosses, the masters who brought us here, that actually the problem is required? It has ever happened. We go back and the people returned me in 2000 because they attempted to impeach me that I was the problem. We went back to the people that brought me with a resounding victory. Overwhelming victory. So you need to cross-check those dynamics and get to understand where the problem lies. It's about people who don't really have to measure up to particular standards you and the philosophies or ideologies you cherish, you espouse. Maybe that's where the problem is. For me, I have a lifetime philosophy that I pursue, that guides what I do. So I am not about to waver. I'm not about to compromise on those values simply because I need to accommodate somebody. That will not happen.
Lord Mayor, when you appointed your former deputy, Lord Mayor, you said you had a shared vision.
So I believed.
You believed. So yes. Are you going to be able to achieve this in your tenure, given that your right hand has now been chopped off?
You see, in any venture, there is a scale of performance. There is the ideal. There is what is attainable. So that's what you have to ask yourself. The ideal is for me to have, the vision I have is to transform this Kampala into a modern city that is accommodating every one of us. A livable city which is inclusive, which is functional with the systems, and that is working for every one of us. That is the overall vision with the modern infrastructure. But of course, there are challenges. There are hurdles we have to jump. So I have to deal with that as well. Of course, there are issues to do with the budget allocations. There are issues to do with the governance system in the country. There are issues to do with the structural challenges here, institutional challenges. And of course, all those dynamics, the individual idiosyncrasies of particular individuals you have to deal with. These are all dynamics you have to deal with. So that may, in a way, affect the final postcard. So I may be having that vision, I may be focusing on the ideals, but the reality may be different. It's not that I concede that I'm being defeated on that particular agenda. No, but I'm giving you the real environment obtaining on the ground, that real environment. And it's what determines the kind of success you are going to get. But by and large, if looking at the postcard,
I've done some tremendous work.
9 years down the road, your vision is yet to be realized. Do you think you deserve re-election?
9 years, that is not, may not be correct, because there were 3 years when I was out of office completely. So you can be talking about 6 years. There are people who have been in office for 34 years, if you are to have that comparative study. So in comparative terms, you ask for those who have been in power for 35 years, uninterrupted, and myself who has been in power for 9 years, interrupted. Yes, you ask yourself, put us on a weighing scale and judge accordingly.
So will you seek re-election in 2021?
That's not a matter you should take a decision upon right now. I believe I needed to sit down with the colleagues. I don't believe in politics of driving personal agenda and ambition. And I also don't believe in the politics of scheming. It's only schemers who take unilateral decision, who will recklessly make statements that may not be reflective of the interests of the wider majority within that particular group. I'm not talking about different formations. I'm talking about a particular group. So I have colleagues I work with. We shall take a decision where to go.
So is it about your political colleagues or it's about the people of Kampala?
I believe in group politics.
So it's not about the people of Kampala, it's about your group politics.
There is always leadership in any given society. And for you need to build the consensus first and foremost with the leadership on a particular matter. Then you get to understand, especially when it comes to issues of standing or not standing, because you can't just go to the people that should I do you endorse my return or not before you generate consensus with colleagues, because it's a teamwork. You get it? Ultimately, it is this team which is going to do the donkey work for you. You have to start with that very team. If they are convinced, then you go down to the people, because if the people look up to you, they say, "Banange, are you bringing for us? Which person is, where is this one?" They wait for the leadership to guide them. So the role of the leadership is to guide the electorate, that this is the person we think should come. Do you buy the idea or not? You get it?
The role of the leadership in FDC, in DP,
because with the team that I work with, and it is that team I am consulting, and we are on a round table, we are discussing. Of course, we are not so much focusing on who should go into which particular position, because now the terrain is not smooth. The political field is not leveled. So we are saying the people of Uganda don't have powers right now. The people of Uganda have no influence on the trajectory, political trajectory of the country. Neither do they have influence on public policy. In other words, actually, they have been held captive. So we are giving priority to that particular issue. That before you talk of competing with Nicholas, with so and so for a particular provision, the field where we are going to play, how is it prepared? If it is skewed in favor of particular individuals, it's as well as a rigged election to be a foolhardy on your part to just go into that exercise. So this is what we are saying. And the fundamental question we are asking, does a ballot paper count in this country? Now, if not, how do we make it count? How do we make it significant, relevant, and influential?
But it took you to Parliament twice, it has made you Lord Mayor twice.
I'm having a holistic picture. It's not about me or one individual or two who may go through, jump the hurdles, who may, one way or the other, because of extra effort and because of lots of things that you have done to make a breakthrough. But it's the whole picture countrywide. Do we have democracy? Do we have what the Constitution talks about as the cardinal principle, that is the sovereignty of the people, in place? Do we have it there? Get it? Those are the fundamental questions.
Several people are warming up to challenge you for the position, including your former colleagues.
I have no time to focus on anyone who would want to assume this public office. I don't have that time. So people, it's at their liberty. I mean, the people are at liberty. It's their right, and the constitutionally guaranteed right, for that matter, to express themselves in any position. But what I'm told you is what I believe in. We are focusing on empowering the people of Uganda so that their decision matters. That is the cardinal point we are focusing on right now.
Before we leave the political question or the governance question in Uganda, what's your take on the revised roadmap of the Electoral Commission?
It's constitutional untenable. In fact, it amounts to an abrogation of the Constitution. The Constitution in Article 61 talks of a free and fair election. This roadmap cannot guarantee that.
Why?
Of course, a roadmap which talks about an exercise that does not involve the people, and it's the people to take a decision. In Article 59, every citizen has a right to cast their vote, and that vote should determine. But now you'll ask yourself, in a situation where you have no campaigns, is that an election? Is it an election? Where you have disenfranchised the people, because this is what I'm saying, in Article 59, the people of Uganda who have majority age, that is 18 and above, and eligible to vote, it's the duty of the state to ensure that they register first and foremost, and two, that they are facilitated to cast their vote, and their vote should count, should influence public policy, should influence the political trajectory of the. But here we are. You are detaching the people from the rest of the world. You are, there are areas where people have got no TV, no radio, no internet, no communication whatsoever. How are they going to make an informed decision? And those are very many. So you are disenfranchising them. The whole thing is, it takes me back to where we started from, actually. The state of emergency, Article 110. Here, let me expound on it. If government had declared the state of emergency, it has a time frame. Say if in March they said it's going to, and the Article 110 talks about 90 days. If it's about extending election in Article 77, it is 6 months. But now I'm talking about a state of emergency for 90 days. if circumstances warrant for extension, you can do it, but the period again shouldn't exceed 90 days. So if by March there was a declaration of state of emergency, it wouldn't last for more than 90 days. And if you are to last beyond 90 days, again there should be a time frame. Now here we are, you are saying nominations for the presidency will be in early November, 8th, 9th there, up to 10th. But we are in June. You have the whole of July, August, September, October, 4 months. And you are still assuming that even by that time, we shall be having COVID around.
But people thought this was something that would go away tomorrow, but it seems up to, they says we have about like, it would take 6 months to find a vaccine.
Let me tell you this. We do not have vaccine for flu. It's not there.
Are you disputing the science?
We do not have vaccine for flu. Common colds. Are you going to suspend an election or to come up with a scientific election because people get flu? On account of people getting flu, you suspend it?
You're calling this COVID-19
a mere flu. There are so many viruses which have gotten no vaccine.
But tens of thousands of people have died, including our neighbors.
How many have died in Uganda?
So you think we should sacrifice public health at the altar of politics?
Let me tell you, I've seen people coming out of those treatment centers.
And there are those that have not come out.
They are dancing. They are jubilating. They are jumping up and down. Whoa, whoa. So the picture they are giving that, after all, by the way, this is not a deadly virus. Have you seen, haven't you seen them? Actually, you people have been screening those scenes.
But and I keep on critically
looking at them. They are dancing.
But let me tell you, there are also mass graves in other countries.
And there are people who have died of malaria, people who have died of other ailments. AIDS kills. So we are told. And it's a fact. AIDS kills. Should you stop weddings? Simply because AIDS kills?
Because the way we contract AIDS is known the same way.
That's what I'm saying. We know how AIDS is contracted. But would you ban marriages?
Or no, you can't.
Let me say, would you ban
outright
sexual intercourse? Let me ask, would you ban sexual intercourse because people will die of AIDS?
We all know how AIDS is contracted.
Yes.
Irresponsible. But this requires
exactly.
Guidelines of
the It's exactly the responsible conduct you are talking about to curb COVID. They are SOPs. Those are the measures we should take. Don't stretch it beyond that. Let people have masks. Let people sanitize. Let people do social distancing. And that is all. And actually, that social distancing thing is also questionable. But I don't want to go there. But the whole point is here, even if it were to be the case that we needed to suspend, to ban campaigns, mass campaigns, it's not the mandate of the EC. That's also another unconstitutional tendency. Because if you are faced with a pandemic...
Who has the mandate to manage elections and their processes?
The people of Uganda.
Through?
Gandhi, read Article 1.
The people of Uganda decide who they want to govern them.
Exactly.
But how the process
the
of
people
how
of
they
Uganda,
get that is...
The people of Uganda have never given their powers to Justice Byabakama and his commission to decide the kind of campaign or election we should have. That's a matter which should be decided by Parliament.
As a political player...
Under Article 110 of the Constitution... It should have been Parliament to take that decision. Do we have an election or not?
So as a stakeholder, are you going to challenge
this? This pandemic, the fundamental question, there are two questions in the wake of this pandemic. Should we have an election or not? If you answer it in the affirmative that yes, we should have it, then the other question which comes in, how or which kind of election? That's not for the EC. That is Parliament. Parliament decides on that. They pass a law and Yabakama would just be obliged to implement that law.
So under the
but now he's the lawmaker, is the one implementing it, is the one defending it. I see him running all over media houses.
But the enabling law gives him the mandate to set guidelines.
No, to regulate campaigns, but not to determine how they should be done. Whether we should have public or mass campaigns or not. That's beyond regulating.
You're saying this is subject to challenging. As a political player, are you considering this?
The people of Uganda have already started challenging it because it's not one form of action that should be taken. You've seen the Kasepichi campaign, people say, coming out and say, no.
The Kasepichi campaign is about
it's about the Noneda campaign. People are saying no need that with scientific election. No need that manipulation.
But as he admitted there and I didn't hear you.
That's a different matter altogether. That's a different, because you have engaged me in this program at this time.
Lord Mayor, it would be unfair to go without talking about infrastructure development in Kampala. One, do you think the amendment to the KCCA Act is for the better or not?
The purpose of a legislation is derived from the spirit, from the philosophy that drives that particular legislation. Which philosophy? So you go back and ask those who amended the act, what philosophy did they have? That should reflect the will of, that should reflect the spirit. No, philosophy which should be reflected in the spirit and letter of that law. It's quite obvious. Read the preamble, the objects clause. It's very, very clear. They wanted to give more powers to the central government as opposed to the elected leadership. Whatever little amendments that were made in favor of the elected leadership, they came by accident and were just out of our pressure, our fight. Otherwise, the overall intention and purpose was just to do away with the leadership, the elected leadership in Kampala.
So no kind of legislation is going to make management of Kampala better?
You see, there is a whole misconception here. Philosophy is important in any legislation before you come to, rather the spirit of philosophy before you come to the letter. And it would be illogical for one to talk of a legislation before you go back to the mindset. So what is important? There should be a mindset at the center, in the central government, actually within Mr. Museveni, General Museveni's government. There should be a mindset, a change of mindset about the elected leadership in Kampala. If that is done, and he believes that actually they should respect the will of the people, they should allow political space to the elected leadership. They should do everything possible to ensure that there is harmony within the institution, that there is streamlining of the functioning, each organ playing their respective roles within the institution. The next thing would be coming up with the legislation to reflect the same. But before you address the mindset, before you address the question of the philosophy, you will never have a good law to deal with the situation in the country.
Lord Mayor, the traffic jam has become a nightmare in your city, but you seem opposed to the proposals of infrastructure development laid on table by the minister, including public reintroducing of public transport.
Where is the plan?
Well, she says she tabled it before cabinet and you were attached. You were copied.
That was tabled before cabinet.
What was tabled before cabinet was a cabinet information paper. That's not a plan.
So should we continue suffering with a traffic jam because there is no...
I'm sorry, you need a plan in each and everything you do. And that's the reason some of us have insisted I'm taking that particular route of planning for the city in all sectors, not only public transport, even in housing, and so on and so forth. Housing, transport, drainage master plan. We needed to plan that. So we have been moving systematically. We hired the consultants from Israel. They prepared the comprehensive report for us 2012. And my fight always has been to push it to another level so that we have a structure plan for Kampala first and foremost, which guides neighborhood planning. And so where do we derive those individual plans? And then we shall have the multimodal transport plan, which is already in the offing for transport in Kampala. And from there, you also have to construct the roads in Kampala. Right now, we have a total network of roads of 2,100, but what is paved is less than 700. So you need to pave more roads. This gambling.
Lord Mayor, do your electorates need a plan or they need buses that is transporting Kampala?
When I was campaigning to be here, I executed the social contract with them. Key of the promises I made was to come up with a plan for Kampala. So by the mere fact that they endorsed my program, my campaign, my agenda, they accepted that indeed they agree with me, they want a plan. You get it? And this is the whole point I'm saying, please, let's develop a plan. The people, there's no way actually, it's even elementary, that which development do you have, a sustainable development, you can talk about which has got no plan. What is that?
But the technical wing seems to have moved on, actually. Yesterday,
The reason we are moving in circles. We have refused to address the basics, to start from the ground, from the core. You see? Every now and again, people are talking about matatus. Your problem is border, but why are they not being solved? You are talking about street vending. You have not constructed the markets. You have not planned for common user facility. They will always be there. You will always be in circles. You get it? Every now and again, they are talking about operations to evict street vendors. Why? We are in circles. So for me, you are saying they have moved. No. If you move in a wrong direction, you will always come back to where I am.
Lord Mayor, you've been accused of trying to use this card to gain political capital. Traders, on street vendors, borders, taxis, but there are those that feel there should be progress and progress should be aligned to infrastructure development in the city.
This narrative that we are politicking, we always want to get political capital, is really misplaced. I fail to understand it. If, for example, you are saying, I am a populist, I want to appease the people, to please them, and to gain political capital. Whose city is it? For me, I believe in the will of the people. Let me tell you, if it is the wish of the people to bring down the Kampala and build another city, so be it. So let's respect the will of the people.
Yes, let's respect the will of the people. We've been speaking to the Lord Mayor of Kampala Capital City Authority, Salongo Edias Lukwago. Thank you for watching Checkpoint. Be sure to catch us tomorrow, same time. Good night.